Lu Xun is widely celebrated as the progenitor of modern Chinese fiction. He is best known for his works of short fiction, such as A Madman's Diary or The True Story of Ah Q, but he's also widely influential as an essayist, commentator, journalist in some sense, and theorist. He had not always aspired to be a writer, however. At first, his intention or plans was to become a medical doctor, a physician. Born in 1881, Lu Xun, who was born Zhou Zhangshou, traveled to Japan in 1902 to pursue his medical education at Sendai University. In 1906, however, Lu Xun cut off his studies of medicine and decided to pursue a career as a writer instead. In his own reflection, which he published in 1922, he recounted one of the pivotal moments that led him to this decision. The story he told was of a classroom in Japan. The instructor had just finished his lectures and now had moved on to projecting photographs using this technology known as lantern slides. These particular photographs came from the Russo-Japanese War of 1904 and 1905. This war had been covered extensively by contemporary media, both through the novel technology of photography and in more classic technologies like woodblock printing. So during this informal session at the end of the lecture, this Japanese instructor showed a photograph that stayed with Lu Xun and disturbed him. It was a photograph of a Chinese man prostrate on his knees, bound just before the moment he was beheaded by a sword-wielding Japanese officer. He was a spy for the Russians, it was explained, and here he was meeting military justice. Now, it wasn't so much the gruesome execution that bothered Lu Xun. It was the background of the photograph. In the background stood a semicircle of men looking upon the scene. These men were mainly Chinese. This is what Lu Xun had to say about that photograph. It was a long time since I had seen any compatriots, but one day I saw a film showing some Chinese, one of whom was bound, while many others stood around him. They were all strong fellows, but appeared completely apathetic. According to the commentary, the one with his hands bound was a spy working for the Russians, who was to have his head cut off by the Japanese military as a warning to others, while the Chinese beside him had come to enjoy the spectacle. It was this moment, Lu Xun claimed, that contributed to a sort of political awakening, the emergence of a political and even a national consciousness that he perhaps did not possess before, or at least to this degree. He became convinced that, counterintuitively, he could do more good for his country, not by curing the physical bodies of Chinese people, but by trying to change their minds through writing. In particular, what bothered him about this photograph was the apparent lack of any sense of national consciousness that these Chinese men looking upon seemed to possess. In theory, they far outnumbered this Japanese military officer. In theory, they could have protested or defended or even overtaken the man, but instead they looked upon this execution almost as a form of spectacle to be enjoyed, ostensibly without any sense of shared identity with the man who was about to die. Now, a question we need to ask here, however, is an obvious one. Why was Lu Xun in Japan when he had this political awakening? One of the major effects of Japan's victory in the First Sino-Japanese War of 1894 and 1895 was to dramatically increase the prestige of Japan in the minds of Chinese reformers and students and later revolutionaries and radicals. Now, this might sound counterintuitive. Why would the prestige of a country increase when you've just lost a war to that country? But we need to remember the following. First, the Sino-Japanese War was fought largely on the Korean Peninsula, and it did not have a major effect on average Chinese people, not during the war at least. We've already discussed in another video that in the aftermath of the war, there was a deep connection with the rise of the Boxer Uprising and the post-Sino-Japanese War tax hikes, which had been geared towards paying off the massive war indemnity, which was enforced upon China by the Treaty of Shimonoseki. But the war itself was not fought in Chinese territory such that it would have produced a sense of resentment against Japan per se. Second, from the perspective of students like Lu Xun, Japan was much closer and far more affordable than other study abroad options, whether Western Europe or the United States. Third, although spoken Chinese language and spoken Japanese language are completely, completely different, the Japanese writing system was and is based in part on Chinese character-based script, known as kanji in Japanese. This made it far easier for Chinese students to study abroad in Japan, as opposed to France or Germany or the United States, where they would have to learn a completely new language and writing system. If the Sino-Japanese War led to the increased prestige of Japan in the eyes of the world, the Russo-Japanese War of 1904-1905 had an even greater effect. In the wake of that war, which Japan won, reformers and radicals and students in China looked to Japan as a model. And that wasn't just true of China. There were admirers of Japanese modernization in Korea, in what we now think of as the Middle East and North Africa. Indeed, W.E.B. Du Bois in the United States wrote glowing and admiring words about Japan following its victory against Russia in that war. For many young reformers, Japan's ability to undertake a crash modernization program, along with all of these factors of cost and proximity and linguistic overlap, made it a kind of super magnet for Chinese students and others at the close of one century and the opening of the next. In the year 1900, there were only about 280 Chinese students in Japan, a very small number. By the end of the Russo-Japanese War, around 1905, however, that number increased to around 8,000, and then grew to 13,000, far more than any other foreign country as a destination for Chinese students. Thus, Lu Xun was not only a foundational figure in the history of modern Chinese fiction and essay writing, he was also emblematic of a new era in which Japan came to play an increasingly central role in the trajectories of Chinese modernizers, students, and revolutionaries.